Well, we are talking with Alan Ripasha right now, one of the most important people in reptile industry for today, and we just have a nice opportunity to ask him some questions. First of all, Alan, thank you very much for Herpeton.
Oh, thank you. Thanks for all of you guys for making the trip.
Thank you. It is a really great event.
Thank you.
Because we really wait and need this event for a long time.
I think so. And Philippe has been dreaming and talking about it for years, and it was always like, you know, how are we gonna pay for this and make it happen? And then finally, you know, my business has been doing good for the last couple of years, and I said, hey, Philippe, if you want to make this happen, then you know, I'll back you 100%, and we'll find a way, and you put up the brains, and I'll put up the dollars, and we'll make it happen, and it worked out, and it was great. It was inspirational. It was, you know, we talked about what we wanted, and what we wanted was to get that energy and emotion back that we had 20 and 30 years ago in the hobby, when before the internet, when, you know, if you wanted to work with a species, you had to maybe find the one or two people that were working with that species, and you had to call them on the telephone, maybe write them a letter, and then go to an exposition or a conference to try to meet this person and convince them that they were someone, that you were someone that they wanted to sell their animals to. Now you just, it's like you have a cookbook on the internet, and you just look up the species and look up the breeders, and you send them a text or an email, and you never even talk to them. And the whole face-to-face, friendship part of the hobby has disappeared.
It is absolutely correct. I can remember how Vivarium magazine inspired me a long time ago.
Yeah, I remember meeting you. I don't know. Maybe it was Orlando or
Orlando first time.
Probably,
and
yeah.
In Ham, maybe 10 years ago.
Yeah, a few times in Ham.
By the way, we discussed the idea of this conference with Philippe 2 years ago.
Oh, yeah.
When I was in New York.
Uh-huh.
And I proposed to organize it in Ukraine. But anyway,
it needs to be an international.
Yes, it needs to be international.
Sure.
And you see, the legislation is making more and more complicated every day, and sometimes it is absolutely unlogical.
Yeah.
And we need to protect our life, our hobby, our reptile world.
Yeah. I think that in the United States we have a little bit of an advantage over Europe right now, because the United States is more unified as one entity, where in Europe you have all of the different countries and you have different animal rights, or you have different legislation throughout those countries, and each country has to defend itself, and instead of gathering together as one organization to defend all of Europe. So I think there's a lot of challenges that need to be overcome.
Definitely.
And then we need to have Europe unite, and the United States is united, and then we need to unite those two together and make it a world view. Because everything that is important to in European hobbyists is important here. We want welfare of the animals. We want to be able to keep our animals have our children be able to keep the animals that we're keeping, and we want to use our animals as ambassadors for nature. You know, I mean, when you hand a child a red-eyed tree frog, for example, I became a father at 50, a first-time father, mm-hmm. and it didn't really click with me until then. And now I have a 6-year-old that's asking questions about everything, and I show her a frog, and she says, "Oh, that's a beautiful frog, but you know, what does it eat? Where does it come from?" And so handing a child a frog ends up being an international discussion about the rainforest and the fact that we need to protect the rainforest so we don't lose the frogs. And so, you know, those are the kind of messages that hobbyists have, and maybe the activists don't think that's what we're you know, that we're interested in that. They just think all we want is our frog in our cage and that's it. But we want to protect, you know, everything.
Yes, we completely appreciate this. That is why in our talk from Bayonne, we suggest we offer this project Responsible Herpetoculture, who could unite the herpetoculturists, herpetologists, and make a bridge between protection and keeping in captivity,
right,
which we call herpetoculture or terrariumistic in Europe, just not to make this alternative, but the kind of synergy. And another thing, I think the main, active members of European community, they could cooperate with main active of American herp communities with great results. They are absolutely ready for this.
Yeah.
And from our side, we are always ready to invite people from United States and our colleagues from Europe to Ukraine to make this forum, Responsible Herpetoculture, to discuss this and other tasks and goals. And of course, the herpeton, mm-hmm, in one or another way should be continued.
Yes, definitely.
Little bit about repasha food, because okay, I think it is very specific business,
mm-hmm,
and it is really business for herpers.
Yeah.
Could you tell me a few words about the idea of this business?
Well, actually, it wasn't really a business idea at all in the beginning. It goes back to when I was partners with Bob Mayhew, mm-hmm, at Sandfire Dragon Ranch, and when we decided to start commercially raising Latoria cerulea. I don't know if it's Latoria anymore,
yes,
but White's,
yes,
tree frogs.
White's tree frogs.
It changes all the time.
It is still Latoria.
Okay. And bearded dragons. We decided to start raising them, in commercial quantities. And so we had to have a very efficient system, and we had to have good survival and maximize production. So when we started breeding the frogs and the dragons in high quantities, we saw, you know, that our survival rate wasn't what we thought it would be. We were struggling with issues like weak animals that didn't hatch well out of the eggs, you know, some metabolic bone disease, but we were doing a lot of stuff outdoors, so that wasn't as important. With the frogs, we had a lot of spawns that didn't survive as well as they should. And so we're talking, you know, 20 years ago, and a good portion of the science of food and nutrition at the time was simply relabeled bird food and bird supplements. The vitamin supplements were typically just adapted from the bird hobby, because there's no research done on reptiles. You know, when humans need something, then money is spent. You know, humans need chickens because it's one of our greatest food items. So they're going to spend millions and millions of dollars of figuring out how to best spend every penny raising chickens, and you're going to maximize, you're going to maximize production by giving them the optimal nutritional levels and vitamins and everything else. But with reptiles, nobody cares except for us. And so I decided to start learning nutrition, to start using our big collection at Sandfire to set up groups of animals and do basically a lot of trial and error. I would take a supplement and put five different levels of vitamin D3 in with the calcium, and then raise the animals and compare the different groups on how well they did. I started consulting nutritionists and scientists and veterinarians on my own, because I didn't have the knowledge. And after, you know, 5 years of trial and error, we started having some, you know, really profound success with what we were doing. And I didn't want to make and market supplements. I was just trying to solve problems at our facility. And then T-Rex, which is one of the larger companies at the time, that manufactured dry goods came to visit us at Sandfire, and I showed them what I was doing, and they're like, "Oh, this is fantastic! You know, can we sell this?" And at the time, I had a calcium supplement. I had another supplement for dusting greens, which was like became Calcium Plus and Super Veggie, and then I had a gut load that I had developed, and I also had the Crested Gecko diet. And the Crested Gecko diet was really a really, really important product because in our facility, feeding insects is messy. It takes a lot of work to raise the insects, and I said if I can take the attraction to fruit that the geckos have and turn that into a complete diet that I can remove the need for using insects with, then I can have a clean breeding facility that I don't have to worry about the pathogens that come in with insects. I don't have to worry about insects, crickets drowning in the water bowls and all of the other things that go along with that. But more importantly, at the time I was thinking, if I can make this food, then it's going to help me sell Crested Geckos. Because
by sure.
When mm-hmm. when a kid goes into Petco or any large pet store and they say, Mommy, I want a lizard or a gecko," mommy says, "Oh, what does it eat?" And the keeper of the store says, "Oh, you have to come back every week and buy crickets." And mommy says, "Let's go look at the fish." You know, it's a big hurdle for a lot of people. And so to be able to market a gecko that says, "Hey, you can feed it out of this jar." I mean, insects are great, and I always recommend that if people can, they feed insects. But to have the ability of taking a 3-ounce jar home and feeding a lizard, a gecko for 3 months, it opened up a whole new window to people that wanted to keep reptiles but wouldn't because of the insect barrier.
How many new diets you're working with?
You mean right now? Or?
Yes, and are you planning something special for chameleon keepers?
Well, I think that we have the chameleons pretty well covered with our Calcium Plus series. We have mm-hmm. a high D, a medium D, which is our regular Calcium Plus.
And does this diet compensate the lack of ultraviolet? Because it is always complicated question.
Yeah, there's so many variables. Mm-hmm. Are people doing it? Yes.
For example, Sergei Prokofiev in Ukraine is breeding thousands of chameleons without ultraviolet.
Without ultraviolet.
Yes.
And Ed Kammer at Camouflage is having great success. I think he still uses UV lights. Mm-hmm. But he doesn't give his animals any outdoor natural sunlight, to my knowledge. Mm-hmm. And he exclusively uses our Calcium Plus to provide all of the vitamins, all of the minerals and everything with his animals. And he's been using our product since almost the beginning. He was using our product for about 5 years before he told anybody he was using it, because he was that concerned and wanted to make sure that it worked, because if he put his name and his reputation on recommending a product, he wanted to make sure that, you know, it did everything that he said it was going to do. So he used it for a long time before he finally came out of the closet and says, "I've been using, you know, I switched to Repashy 5 years ago, and we dust every time we feed." That's another thing that a lot of people in the chameleon hobby have a lot of preconceptions that are passed down from keepers that were from an era where nutrition wasn't well understood, and they think that if you dust an animal more than once every, dust a cricket more than once a week or once every 2 weeks, that you're gonna create hypervitamintosis D or the whole vitamin A thing. We could have a whole video about vitamin A and chameleons. Because that there's been more animals that have suffered because of a lack of vitamin A when it comes to chameleons than the other way around. People are so afraid of vitamin A toxicity that they went to the other end of the spectrum and decided that the only thing they were going to give them was beta carotene, which now, you know, 20 years later has been shown to not be absorbed the way that we thought it was, and that there's definitely a need for preformed vitamin A, and you can't just provide beta carotene and have great success.
Thank you very much. Let's come back to herpetoculture. What difficult does commercial herpetoculture face today? What do you think? What threats await it tomorrow?
The biggest threats right now are legislation. You know, in the United States, we have, like Europe has many countries, we have many states, and the states function independently in a lot of ways, and even down to the level of not just the state, but a county or a city or even a town. You know, a town of 1,000 people can go to the mayor and they can decide that they don't want anyone in that town to keep reptiles, and they can vote it into law. And it's crazy, but it happens. And so, you know, it happens on small scales, it happens on larger scales. The larger scales of these events get the attention of USHARC and the other organizations that come in and present the facts and usually have good luck. But when a small town makes up a law and there's no herpers in the town that raise a flag, these little laws can pop up, and they're popping up all around, and then they're the beginning, and then every time one of these laws goes into effect, then someone else is trying to make a law, uses that as an example, and it just snowballs. And so defending our rights to keep reptiles and amphibians is huge. And then also, in my opinion, another big threat is obviously our environment and what's happening to the rainforests and the regulations. You know, a lot of countries put regulations on animals that restrict them from being brought into captivity when they're really counterproductive. You know, I go back. I always use an example of a conversation I had with Willie Henkel in New Caledonia. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Rhacodactylus leucianus live in 100-foot old-growth trees. And unless you are a good tree climber or you're really lucky, they're very difficult to find. And so I said, Willie, how did you go on these trips and come and catch 10 leucianus? That's like, you know, I went to New Caledonia 3 times to find one. And he said, we made arrangements to go out with the logging companies, and we followed the bulldozers. They knocked the trees down, mm-hmm. and then we went around the trees and looked in the hollows and took out the geckos. So it's like, are we taking those animals out of the environment? No, the environment is dead. The bulldozers are knocking it down, and those animals are dead when that heat tree hits the ground. And to not allow, in situations all over the world like that where they're deforesting, to go in and save some of these animals from these areas that are being destroyed, it doesn't make any sense to me. I don't. Does it make any sense to you?
No. We both know well the situation on Madagascar.
Yes, that's a great example. Yeah,
because we visited this amazing magic island for many, many times. And we see the main threat is decreasing of habitats.
Yeah.
And from one side, all proper habitats for Parson chameleons could be smashed in near future. From other side, the export quota could be also closed.
Right.
So the only possibility to save many rare species from Abronia to Parsonia, much, much, much more, is to make this satellite reserve population.
Absolutely.
With all proper statistics, with passports, with everything. And it should be challenged not only for hobbyists, but also for zoos. Mm-hmm. It is just kind of genetic pool.
Yeah, making and there's more potential and space in private herpetoculture than there is in the zoos. The zoos don't have the facilities and the time to focus on so many species. And then even within Parsonai, that you've got different different localities. They're all called Parsonai now. But if you go to the different localities and you look at the animals, I think Peter's talk, he was talking about, you know, these animals in this area are different, and without data, you know, GPS data from where these animals came, you know, if we ever get to the point where we can start reforesting and reintroducing animals, we need to know where exactly, you know, these animals came from, so we can put them back in the right locality.
Alan, what countries you have already visited? At one countries you want to visit in the future?
Wow. I spent a lot of time in Australia. I did 6 or 7 trips, about 6 months.
Very interesting.
6 months total in Australia, as far as herping. New Caledonia, Fiji. I've pretty much been all over Europe. I haven't been to many Eastern European countries. I think the farthest east I've been is the Czech Republic. Mm-hmm. But Western Europe, I've been all over Europe and Spain. I haven't been to African continent at all.
Have you been in Madagascar?
I have not been to Madagascar.
If we will plan expedition,
I need to go before there's nothing left to see.
I invite you to join us. Believe me, it should be a fantastic trip.
Yeah.
And also, I want to take this opportunity to invite you to visit Bayonne in Ukraine.
Yes, I look forward to that.
Next time when we establish this project, it should be
great. It'll be for a conference.
For conference.
Yeah.
And tell me, please, what are your plans for future?
It's a good question. I mean, a lot of what I look at now is holding on. You know, we're growing every year, I'm more worried about holding on to what we have, because if the herp trade crashes because of the lack of availability or biodiversity of species, if legislation comes in and restricts people's ability to keep reptiles, then that directly affects my business because I'm selling, you know, food and supplements for these animals. So it's of personal interest, and I've, you know, put my money where my mouth is, and I invest in U.S. I donate to U.S. ARC. We you know, put a lot of resources into education already, and we're going to improve that now that everyone at Herpeton is kind of, we've got this melting pot that we created last week at the symposium. I felt it. I'm sure you felt it.
Exactly.
And this energy hopefully is going to boil over, and we're going to be able to get out there through rescues and rehoming, fighting legislation, organizing our herp clubs here in the States, and trying to, you know, hold on to what we have, and ensure that our children have the same ability to do what we're doing. So that's more of a concern for me than making new products right now. So my plans are to keep things the way they are.
Mm-hmm.
As far as products go, I'd like to. I've been talking to one of my veterinary nutritionists that I consult with, Ellen Deerenfield. I've been discussing with her on doing some critical care rescue formulas for veterinary use and the advanced hobbyists, I guess you would say. These would be formulas that would be highly digestible, high fat, that are syringe fed for animals that are sick, animals that are dehydrated from whether it's from shipping, whether it's from poor care in one situation, they've come into another situation where someone is giving them better care. But we've started working a lot with veterinarians and zoos, and I really enjoy that part of my business. And this year I'm going to one of the larger veterinary conferences, and we're going to set up our first table at a vet conference. And it's like, for me, it's like making the foods and stuff, it's really become a passion, and to be accepted in the hobby.
It is the only way to have success, to make something, to be a patient.
To be accepted by hobbyists and have hobbyists say, I really like your food, it works really good, is great. But when a zoo nutritionist comes to you or a veterinarian comes to you and says, I recommend your products to all my customers, that's that means a lot to me.
Yes, by sure.
You know, because they don't do that for hardly anybody else. We're probably the most recommended line among professionals, the people that really have the opinions.
It is
matter.
True.
Yeah.
Tell me, please, do you think that U.S. herpetoculture should have the connection, or I tell in other words, do you think we need some international herpetoculture organization?
Yeah, I definitely think we do, because we all have the same goal as keepers.
Because I spoke to Phil, USARC president, and he told me that it should be good to have some partner in Europe, other countries, for communication, for cooperation.
Yeah. I also think, too, that because I'm also a fish hobbyist, I think that uniting the fish hobbyists, the fish people, have no idea what's coming. I mean, they're seeing it a little bit, but they haven't had the battles that we've had in the reptile hobby. They could learn a lot from what's been going on in the reptile hobby. And I think that, like, in a perfect world for me, I would see reptile and aquarists uniting together in the U.S. and in Europe into one large organization, because I mean, bottom line is, you know, these battles take funds and money.
So you already have this example, successful example.
Absolutely.
It's very good. I'm very gratitude for this meeting, and I also appreciate very much our Bayon's participants in at Herpeton.
Yeah.
It was really very positive, very useful, and important events for all of us.
I think so. We really appreciate you. You became our first international sponsor. So it was nice to have some European flavor at the conference. And next year, if we do this again in San Diego like we think we do, we hope to get more international involvement. And then we can take this formula and bring it to Europe and maybe have a sister conference or an alternating conference.
I think it
like
should
that.
Be... It should be really important. We really do not need a lot of people, but we need a speaker, decision makers, and active part of herpetoculturists who could share and support all our ideas.
Yeah. I have to be honest. Like Philippe and I, you know, Philippe's been talking about having something like this for a long time, and it was just over Christmas holiday that we decided to make this happen, you know, and it was like, well, should we just go for it and have it in 5 months and see what happens, or do we wait a year and a half and do more planning? And we kind of both agreed. It's like, let's just do it. In America, I don't know if you have the same expression, but we said, you know, you take a pile of shit and throw it against the wall and see if it sticks, or see what sticks, you know, and see if enough sticks to make it worthwhile. And until 2 months ago, you know, Philippe and I, Philippe and I were still trying to decide if we were going to cancel it, because we weren't sure. People didn't sign up. Everyone waits till the last minute. And, you know, we're looking at huge expenses, a big commitment to the hotel. And I just said, Philippe, it's going to come together. Just have faith and let's just go for it. And if not, then I've got a good tax write-off for my business.
Yes, I like and support this idea from the beginning.
Yeah.
And I offer Philippe to invite Evgeny Rybaltovsky.
Yes.
And absolutely, absolutely
it would have
fantastic.
Been fantastic, but yes. To get a Russian visa in 5 months with the state of politics the way they are was just not possible.
But I'm sure in case of possibility, he will come.
Yeah.
And also, I suggest to invite Piotr Nechas, who is chameleon expert. And all these talks were interesting.
Yeah.
I spent a wonderful time.
Yeah.
Thank you once more, and hope to see you in Ukraine soon.
I'll see you soon. Thank you.